Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ خَلْقُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَاخْتِلَافُ أَلْسِنَتِكُمْ وَأَلْوَانِكُمْ. All these verses from verse number 30, going all the way down. A few of them, they are similar in wording. Allah says, from His signs, that He has created the heavens and the earth. He created different creatures. And He created you with all different أَلْسِنَتِكُمْ, your languages and your colors. All the diversity is a sign of Allah. The fact that someone is black, someone is white, someone is yellow, someone is pink, all these are the signs of Allah. Someone speaks in the accent we speak in, someone speaks in a different accent, a different language. Subhanallah, these are the signs of Allah. He created all this diversity so that we don't get bored on earth. It's a sign of Allah. If all of us spoke the same language, all of us looked exactly the same, all of us did everything exactly the same, it would be very boring. Life would be so boring. Subhanallah. You would have to line up and get married to the next number. Subhanallah. That's what it would be. Imagine. Who are you married to? 456. And you? 457. Okay. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us understanding. But Allah created different likes. You might like something I don't, and I might like something you don't. Subhanallah. The same applies to food. If Allah wanted, we could have had capsules every day, morning, suhoor and iftar, one capsule and you're done. But Allah gave you apples and bananas and pears and oranges and meat and beef and chicken and fish and what have you, and different types of vegetables and so on. This is all the gift of Allah. He made it diverse. He says that is a sign of Allah. Sit and think about it. Save yourselves from belittling Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by considering the various gifts He has bestowed upon you. If you don't, you're belittling Allah. He gave you colors. Imagine the colors we have. What if everything was just black and white? Subhanallah. The colors we have. Today we are dressed with so many different colors. I remember someone asking me, why do you wear a different color every day? Well, I can tell you today so that the viewers can know that today is a different day. They need to listen. I haven't yet seen this particular color. I think this is a different talk. That's the true reason. Subhanallah. There's no other reason. If you recall, I was in this masjid many years ago and I only had one of these. And people used to say, but I think I heard this. And I said, no brother, listen to it. You haven't heard it. They had to go via the number of the episode. Now they've got to go via the color. Have you watched the green? No, I haven't. Have you seen the blue? No, I haven't. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us. This is a sign that Allah has bestowed upon us. It's a gift of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Really. These colors we appreciate. And that's just one example, but there are so many other examples that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed us with.
Political strife has always led to enhanced racism. Just traditionally, even today, by the way, whenever it's the divide and conquer rule, when an authority is failing, that he pits his people against each other, right? Through empty slogans and through racism. You know, look at us as an ummah today, mashallah, we're boasting about these flags that were given to us by the British. We were colonized, and we're holding up these flags, hanging them up in our shops, right? Putting them on our cars and so on and so forth. And these are the flags that were given to us by those who colonized us. And we're willing to kill each other over these flags. So political strife has always led to enhanced racism. And it's important for the Arabs in particular to understand the pre-Islamic hatred and disdain that Arabs had for black people, which was a very recent conflict that took place before the Prophet ﷺ. All right, so what was the tension all about? It really starts off with the Abyssinians, Ahlu Habasha, the Abyssinians, modern day Ethiopia. The Abyssinians, they trace their lineage, and this is actually very interesting because we said that Sulaiman alayhi salam is described as having dark skin. The Abyssinians trace their lineage to Sulaiman al-Bilqis, the Queen of Sheba. So they trace their lineage all the way back to Sulaiman alayhi salam. In the 6th century, so we're talking about right before the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Abyssinians were allied themselves with the Romans, with the Byzantines, who were Christians, all right? And the Persians, you know, were fighting against the Christians, the Persians who were Zoroastrian. All right, so there was this huge war that was taking place in the world between the Romans and the Persians. Allah references it in Surah Rum. And basically at that time, subhanAllah, if you look at a world map at that time, in that entire region, when I was talking about the Arab world, but you're really talking about the world at that time, was one big battle between the Romans and the Persians, and everyone, you know, allied themselves with one of those two groups. So the Muslims, as we saw later on, they allied themselves with the Christians because they were muwahideen, and they were people who worshipped one God in some way, all right? Whereas Quraysh, they allied themselves with the Persians. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought about the defeat of the Persians in the same year that he brought about the defeat of the Quraysh in Badr. So the Romans defeated the Persians at the same time that the Muslims defeated Quraysh, the polytheists. So there was this, you know, this alliance between, just it was a moral alliance, right? An attachment that the Muslims had to the Romans as well, to the Christians. Now at that time, before Islam, before that all starts, Abyssinia, the Abyssinians were allied with the Romans. The Arabs as a whole were allied with the Persians. They were polytheists and they were allied with the Persians. Now, why is this significant? Because geographically speaking, Abyssinia was alone in supporting the Romans in its region. They used to call Abyssinia an island of Christianity in the land of in the sea of polytheism. An island of Christianity in the sea of polytheism. Abyssinia maintained its Christianity as well as its attachment to the Romans. So Abyssinia was always problematic, historically speaking. All right. Now, the Abyssinia king at the time was named Abraha. Now it's going to start to make a little bit of sense if you've taken Sunday school classes and sort of steel and stuff like that. Abraha al-Ashram. Abraha was an Abyssinian king, and he led an army against the ruler of Yemen at the time. The ruler of Yemen was Dhu Nuwas, and he was a Jew. So the ruler of Yemen, and we're talking about the early 6th century, was a Jew, and he used to persecute the Christians. So in the year 547, Abraha, the Abyssinian king, he leads this huge army into Yemen, and he conquers Yemen in the year 547, and he claims himself actually to be the ruler of Hijaz, the entire Arabian Peninsula, so not just Yemen, but the entire Arabian Peninsula. He persecutes the Jews because of the fact that the Yemeni king was Jewish, and he persecuted the Christians. And he builds this huge church in Yemen. All right. Now, when he builds this huge church in Yemen, he expects people to come and to all become Christian, all of the Arabs to become Christian. What ends up happening? The church does not gain the prominence that he wanted it to gain. He says, why? He says, well, there's the Kaaba in Mecca. People tell him there's the Kaaba in Mecca where the Arabs devote themselves to. So that's actually why Abraha decided to lead that march to Mecca to demolish the Kaaba. All right. So obviously that was in the year what? I'm going to ask you guys here, what year was that? 570, the year the Prophet ﷺ was born. Aam al-Fil, the year of the elephant. Okay. When Abraha led this army of elephants to Mecca to demolish the Kaaba, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala destroyed him and his army, as is referenced in Surah Al-Fil. Now, we don't really know what happens in history after that, right? Sunday school doesn't go beyond 570 in Aam al-Fil. Then it just transitions into the Prophet ﷺ. But what do you think happened now between the Arabs and the Abyssinians? He was an Abyssinian king who declared himself the ruler of the Arabs, tried to destroy the most, you know, whether you were whatever you were at that time, you held the Kaaba in high esteem. He tried to destroy their most sacred monument, okay? And so obviously the tension between the Arabs and the Abyssinians was high. After Aam al-Fil, what ends up happening is that the Abyssinians that stayed behind in the Arab world were captured and taken into slavery. Okay, so the Abyssinians were taken into slavery. Amongst them was the mother of Bilal radiallahu ta'ala anhu. You see, so slavery existed amongst them in many different ways. There's debt slavery, there's selling your children into slavery, there is concubinery, there is sex slavery. All of these types of slavery exist in the world at that time. And the world economy runs on slavery at that time as well. Not just in the Arab world. But one of the forms of slavery was obviously through battle and so on and so forth. So these Abyssinians were considered as being at war with the Arabs, who continued to remain in alliance with the Persians. So they just captured all of these Abyssinians and took them in as slaves. All right. So Abraha is killed, the Abyssinians are taken as slaves. And in the Arab world at the time, as we know, it was all about your lineage. It was all about your tribe. So if you had no tribe, you were already humiliated. Okay? Being darker meant further discrimination. So being a slave was a humiliating state in and of itself, but being an Abyssinian slave in particular meant only further cruelty. Why? Because it was still a fresh conflict in the Arab world in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam fought this discrimination, which again was at the heart tribalistic. Even before Islam, it was still tribalistic. It was not, the Abyssinians were not enslaved because they were black. They were enslaved because of battle and tribalism and so on and so forth, okay? The Prophet ﷺ was fighting this even before he's a Nabi of Allah, even before he's a prophet. And that's why he was the youngest member of Hilf al-Fudul, the youngest person to take the pact, amongst the Arabs, that they would not allow anyone to be discriminated against on the basis of their tribe or where they came from, their tribe or their lineage. So Rasulullah ﷺ was fighting this very early on, before he's a prophet of Allah. And he was the, you know, you can imagine a man in his 20s standing amongst people that are in their 70s and their 80s, the seniors of the tribes. And Rasulullah ﷺ was a member of that pact, which shows you that the Prophet ﷺ was an activist for social justice before he was a prophet of God. SubhanAllah, he was already an activist for these things. Okay, so that's pre-Islamic.